It's a pleasure to introduce Lynne Boddy for this lecture. She's really one of the greats in mycology, and I think anyone that's in this field, I really wouldn't need to introduce her at all, but I'm supposed to, so I will. She received her PhD from Queen Mary College in London in 1980, and went on to a short postdoc with Alan Rayner, a short but very productive postdoc with Alan Rayner at Bath. And by 1983, she went to Cardiff as a lecturer, and then moved up the ranks there, and by 1996 was a full professor, which many of you may know in the European system, a full professor means a good deal more than it means here. She won the Berkeley Award from the British Mycological Society, which is spelled Berkeley, as an outstanding young researcher, and also the Fleming Award from the Society of General Microbiology. She's a past president of the British Mycological Society, and she's authored over 300 scientific articles on fungi, especially in the area of saprotrophic fungi, which is saprotrophic fungal ecology, which is really what she's known for. She's edited numerous books and co-authored three books where she was basically one of two or three authors. So, I mean, she really wrote books. And one of the ones she's proudest of is From Another Kingdom, The Amazing World of Fungi, which was part of a multimedia presentation of the fungi at the Royal Botanical Gardens in Edinburgh. And she'll have a new textbook on mycology coming out next year called The Fungi. She's here for the duration of the semester, or for
3 months.
3 more months as a Miller professor. So you'll have a chance to interact with her if you want to, and you can have a chance right after this talk to interact with her in 3:38 because we'll have a reception. And without wasting any more of your time, here's Lynne Boddy.
Well, thank you very much, Tom. That was very kind. I guess there are probably a couple of million species of fungi, so obviously I'm only going to tell you about a very narrow range of those. I'm going to tell you about wood decay basidiomycetes. They are the sorts of things which produce toadstools or brackets or gelatinous masses or skins on the surface of wood. But I'm not going to show you any pictures of these, or indeed tell you anything about toadstools or mushrooms. So if you've come here for that, that's rather bad luck. I'm going to be telling you about the mycelium, because mycelium is the business part of the fungus. It's the part of the fungus which grows and spreads, secretes enzymes, which break down big molecules into small ones, which are then absorbed for the fungus to grow more. And it's the part of the organism, the fungus, which interacts with other organisms. It's the part that fights. And probably by the end of this talk, you'll actually have basidiomycelium indelibly marked on the backs of your retinas, because this background here is a picture of that, and it's the backdrop for all of my slides, or almost all of them. And the mycologists in the audience will verify it is a basidiomycete, because they will have spotted already the telltale signs of clamp connections. I thank Paul Stamets for that lovely image. And while we're on thanks, I would like to acknowledge all of these people, and probably I should have more on the list, who have helped over the years to put together this story which I'm going to tell you. And you might recognize a couple of names there. Ignacio Chapella, who sat here in the front row, and Catherine Eyre, so they'll be able to answer all the hard questions at the end. Oh, this is a good sign. Okay, let's try. There we go. Right, let's get into the swing of this and think about interactions. This is a typical sort of system we might use for studying interactions. It's a tray of soil. It happens to be about 24 by 24 centimeters. Fungi rarely exist alone, and when they meet another one, they fight. And you can see that here. This is Phanerochaeta veleutina, this is Hypholoma fasciculari. They met about there, and you can see that by one means or another, Phanerochaeta is pushing its way through. It's destroying Hypholoma and replacing it. There are lots of different ways by which it does this, and you'll see other pictures of this combination. They don't always look the same. We can see signs of interactions everywhere we look in a woodland. Chop up a piece of wood or make it into a dish or something like this, and you can see all these beautiful zone lines, interaction zone lines. These demarcate different individual fungi. They can be individuals of the same species. Fungi can recognize themselves in the same way as you and I can. Or they can be individuals of different species. But they demarcate the interaction between the two. They have a wide range of mechanisms by which they can attack or defend their territory. Some are antagonistic at a distance, and you can see that here on this agar plate, where neither of these cultures have met each other, but they are impeding each other. You can see that they are antagonized by the fact that the two mycelia have not come together. Now, actually, that's an agar plate, and perhaps I should stay at this stage. I will be showing a few pictures of fungi growing in culture, and our work started at looking at interactions in culture, but we rarely do this now because, surprise, surprise, agar plates are really rather far removed from the real world. So we've tried to look in soil trays, like you've seen already, or indeed actually in wood. So antagonism at a distance. Hyphal interference is another mechanism where one hypha touches another one. This is a classic example. This is Phlebia gigantea, or whatever it's called now, interacting with Heterobasidion anosum, a pathogen of conifers. And you can see the state of this Heterobasidion hypha. The compartment that was contacted is a bad state. It's died. Enough of these contacts and the whole mycelium dies. And indeed, this is the basis for the biological control of this fungus. Mycoparasitism, very similar really to hyphal interference, where typically hyphae might coil around those of another one, or at least liad pressed closely to the surface, often penetrating inside and abstracting nutrients. And this might be the only way it obtains its nutrition, or it might be a way of getting the territory that the other fungus occupies, if it's a wood decay fungus, and then it might carry on wood decaying and killing other fungi in some other way. And then the last category, really, it's a very poor name, and it's a catch-all category. Gross mycelial contact, where massive interactions occurring along a huge front. And really, that title covers a multitude of sins. And the truth is, we really don't know how most of these interactions occur or operate. But I will illustrate some of them to you. So, when fungi meet, they fight, and there are instantly changes in the morphology of the fungus. And associated with these changes, there are changes in physiology, biochemistry, etc., etc. You can see some of the morphological changes, these massed barrages of mycelium. There's another one there. The colour of this picture isn't quite right. It shouldn't be quite that pink. Aggregated structures like these mycelial cords. You can see there's a gap there where one of these fungi has produced masses of enzymes which have destroyed the other, and then it's come across that gap as mycelial cords. We often get pigment production associated with these interactions. So you can see here these blood red pigments, which really are reminiscent of a battlefield of ancient times. And often green pigments. I'm not quite sure what that's reminiscent of. This is a rather good one. Look, that really shows antagonism at a distance, really quite beautifully. And these pigments can be produced by the attacker or by the defender. So an example of the attacker here, this is Phanerochaeta attacking Stropharia. You can see the massive pigment production. There it is in close-up. And this time it's the defender. This is Stropharia attacking Hypholoma. And you can see there are the cords coming in and this pigment around it. This may be indicating oxidation of phenolics. It may be indicating nothing much at all other than a correlation with other secondary metabolites being produced. So the pictures that I've showed you so far are all static and instant in time. But of course, these interactions are dynamic. They're always changing. So let's look at a sequence of interactions. Again, these are trays of soil. I should say that this is not sterile soil. It's soil straight from the field, so we really are mimicking the real world as closely as we possibly can. None of this microbiological nonsense of sterility. Fungi colonized wood blocks, and there they've met. This is the stinkhorn fungus, Phallus impudicus. This is Stropharia originosa. And just note those points that I've indicated there, because I want you to see those on the next image. You can see that there was a barrage of mycelium there produced by Stropharia, but Phanerochaete has managed to get across the top, and it's actually managed to grow to the wood blocks. Now, it hasn't replaced the mycelium of Stropharia, but when it gets to the wood block, it can start to fight within the wood, and there it will replace the Stropharia. A bit later on, the mycelium is getting sparser and sparser. Later on still, even more sparse. And actually, we can quantify all this using image analysis, but I haven't put that in for you today. Right, let's see if we can get this going, because this mouse wasn't working a few seconds ago. Okay, so we're off. This is Trometes vesicolor, this is Daldinia concentrica. They've met on agar. Trometes is exuding lytic enzymes. You can see that it's lysed Daldinia there. Massed ranks of mycelium of Trometes is going through that lysed region. More enzymes are being produced, more Daldinia being lysed. The fungus marches on. In fact, it's getting up such a head of steam now that it's charging through even before you can see evidence of that lytic region. And if we watched this long enough, we'd find that the whole plate was completely replaced. The timescale for this is just a couple of days that you're seeing there. On an agar plate, a week would see the other fungus completely replaced. See another one then that's a little closer to the real world. A tray of soil with two fungi growing out of twigs. This is Phanerochaete, this is Hyphaloma. And the two fungi will meet here in a minute. Actually, Hyphaloma pops around the top as well. You can see it coming in a moment. Ah, Hyphaloma is beginning to replace Phanerochaete. I got very excited the first time I saw this, because that's not normally what happens. Will Hyphaloma completely replace Phanerochaete? We might never know, because the photographer got bored and stopped filming. So I've given you some hints already about some of the ways that these interactions might be occurring. We've mentioned enzymes are being produced prolifically. So are other diffusible compounds and volatiles. And I'd like to tell you a little bit more about the production of volatiles. So here, a picture we've shown already, Resinicium bicolor against Hyphaloma fasciculari. You can see it there on agar. But the data I'm now going to show is when the fungi interact in wood. So we've colonized two blocks of wood separately. That one's got Resinicium in. That one's got Hyphaloma in. Paired them together and then seen what happens. So we just took headspace gas and then had a look and see what volatiles were in there by GCMS. And there's an illustration here at the bottom. So the red line is when Hyphaloma is paired against itself. And these peaks indicate some of the chemicals being produced. That's Resinicium, the green, when it's paired against itself. There's a peak there. But look at the blue color when Hyphaloma fights with Resinicium. Masses of new peaks. There's also some downregulation. That red peak is now rather smaller. So a huge change in the volatiles that are produced during interactions. And I guess that you can identify what each of these chemicals are. And people have suggested, well, why don't you just do that and then buy them in bottles on the shelf and see what effect that has on other fungi. And of course, you could do that. But it's not necessarily a sensible thing to do, because fungi are responding not to one chemical, not to one volatile, but to a whole bouquet of volatiles. And so, rather than do that, we just made systems like this where two fungi are interacting in wood on the top, and then at the bottom we had soil with one fungus growing out across the soil. And you can do very simple things like look at the extension rate or hyphal coverage or the fractal dimension and other things using image analysis. So, Racinium against racinium in the top here, hypholoma against itself, these are the controls, then racinium against hypholoma. Obviously we've tried lots and lots of fungi, but I'm just giving you a few examples here. So what effect do these have on hypholoma when it's at the bottom? Well, racinium decreases the extension rate, it inhibits extension of hypholoma. But then so does hypholoma itself. On the other hand, when racinium is paired with hypholoma, it actually increases the extension of racinium. So a whole host of complex things going on. Now, this is volatiles being produced by two blocks of wood, or by fungi and two blocks of wood paired together. But obviously, they will produce volatiles when they grow across soil and fight. And we know what they are too. I'm not showing you that today. They produce different things. And this is really a message, I think, for the postgrads in the audience. I always tell my students, read all the literature you can. Listen to everything I've got to say, but don't necessarily believe any of it. Make your own judgments when you've got good knowledge. And this next experiment is a good case in point to illustrate this. The student who did this work came along and said to me, I know what I'm going to do next, she said. I'm going to do the same experiment, but this time at the top we'll have fungi interacting, growing across the surface of soil. And I said, well, are you sure? Because the soil will fall out. There's this thing called gravity. Anyway, she just went away, and then a week later she came back and she said, would you like to see the experiment that I've just set up? And I said, yep. Well, she'd done it. She'd set her soil up. But it turns out that if you moisten soil and you press it into the top, it doesn't fall out at all. So you can do that experiment. And we won't go through the results, but you can just see that there are different arrows in different places of different sizes. So you get in different effects there. Well, probably by now you'll be thinking, what's going on as far as gene expression is concerned? And we started to look at this, well, I don't know, 6, 7, 8 maybe years ago, and it's work that Catherine Eyre did for her PhD. So it's quite good, really, because if there's any questions, you can ask her later. but I'm only going to touch upon this briefly, because we have now moved on, as the technology has moved on, to looking at transcriptomics and secretomics. But you'd have to invite me back next year to find out about that. So what Catherine did, which was really great at the time, she looked at this fungus, Trametes vesicolor, a very common fungus, which you get here too, interacting with Sterium gaussopatum, and Trametes beats Sterium. She looked at the scenario where Trametes deadlocks with another fungus, neither gain any headway, and she looked at the scenario where Trametes was beaten by another fungus. And she constructed subtractive cDNA libraries, looked at this, and guess what? There are lots of things upregulated, lots of things downregulated. Some of the genes are found in all of the combinations and some in only one or two. And we then went on in another project to look more specifically at lacase with the same types of setup here. But this time, rather than just looking in one region, we looked in different parts of the mycelium. So we looked in the interaction zone line, a bit further back, and a bit further back still. And this is the interaction zone line. This is when Trametes is against itself, against Stereo and Gaussopartum, against Jocandra, and against the thing that replaces it. And you can see that there are some differences in gene expression. This actually was much clearer when we looked at enzyme activity. There's the what we saw in the interaction zone line. So maybe it's that gene expression is transient, but the enzyme is built up, the enzyme activity builds up. I don't know. We can look at where some of the enzymes are produced really rather simply by staining reactions. So here we're looking at the production of lacase, here manganese peroxidase, and here a general peroxidase stain. It would have been better actually if I'd given a time course of these, because the colour to start with is green where lacase is produced, then it goes purple, and then if there's a lot of activity it goes clear. So anyway, you can see the regions where lacase is produced. Look at these other ones though. Manganese peroxidase is much more localised. And look at this peroxidase one here, right around that invading front just there. So we can get a bit of a feel for where these enzymes are produced. But moving on, I've talked already in passing about outcomes of interactions. It's obviously clear to you that there are different outcomes. We can have deadlock, where neither fungus gains any headway. Replacement, where one fungus takes over the territory of another one completely and can use its wood as food. There's partial replacement, where one fungus does rather well to start with, and then suddenly it can't take any more territory. Maybe the defences have been switched on by the other fungus at that stage, or maybe the environmental conditions have changed. And there's this rather strange one, mutual replacement, where one of the fungi replaces the other in part of the encounter, and the other one replaces elsewhere. And you can see an example of that just here in this agar culture. This fungus on this side is replacing through the middle here. That's not just overgrowth, it's actually replacing in the agar as well. On the other hand, this fungus is replacing around there. And they can almost sort of completely swap territories. Similar things starting to happen here. This is on soil. This mycelium is growing over that one there, and yet this one is growing over in that case here. But in this case, there's no evidence of replacement yet. That's just overgrowth, a different issue. Well, that's okay. We can see those sorts of things in agar. We can see these sorts of things in soil. But it's less easy to visualize what is going on in wood. But we want to know how and over what timescales replacements can occur. So we've recently done experiments where, again, one block of wood with one fungus, another block with another fungus, put them together, make loads of replicates, sacrifice at lots of different time intervals to see where the fungus is. And that's what's illustrated in this picture here. We'll just look maybe at this column. This happens to be for an early colonizer called Voluminia comedens. We've got time along the bottom, and how much territory is occupied by each fungus at the y-axis. So that's the control, we won't think about that one. This is paired against Trametes. So this top part here, that indicates when we started, Trametes has all the territory in one block. This pale blue colour indicates that Voluminia has all the territory in another block. And this carries on like this for well over a month. Then suddenly, Trametes replaces Voluminia. What happens then? Why does it suddenly do that? How can it suddenly do that? I don't know yet. This is against Stereo hirsutum. Well, that's deadlock all the time, no change. This fungus here, Jocandra, eventually takes the territory. Hypholoma eventually takes the territory. And this great fighter here, Fanariciti, look, after just perhaps a few days, it is able to replace. So you can see that, in fact, there's lots of different abilities as far as combat and fighting is concerned. And we can see a hierarchy of combative ability that's a bit like a sports league. So you have a sports league where the teams that win are at the top of the table, the teams that mostly lose or draw are at the bottom. So these at the top are all those fungi which are the great fighters and beat most of the rest, and then increasingly less good, till we have these at the bottom, which are the really rather poor combatants. But it's really quite like a sports league in that just because you're the bottom of the league, bottom of the table, doesn't mean you always lose. You might actually beat somebody really rather high up. So it's a strange situation. Voluminia comedens could be the equivalent of the Cow Bears football team. The outcome of interactions varies depending on conditions. It depends on where the interaction is occurring. So if the interaction is occurring in wood, fungus might replace another one, but maybe it doesn't when it's meeting it across soil. And very often interactions in agar can be totally different from those in more natural scenarios. The climatic environment can be important too. Temperature, water, pH, gaseous regime. Likewise, the amount of resources a fungus has access to, and the quality of those resources. Has it got lots of nitrogen? Is it well decayed? Is it too well decayed? Are other organisms present, including microbes and indeed invertebrates in soil? And I'll illustrate a couple of those for you. So let's look at the microclimate ones. So this is a picture, a still, of the time lapse that you saw earlier with Trometes against Daldinia concentrica, the ascomycete. And we know that Trometes wins eventually. In a week or so's time, it will be completely over here. But if you lower the water potential, so make it harder for the fungi to get water, a complete shift. Daldinia beats Trometes. Lower it even further, and, well, Trometes can't get going at all. Temperature has a big effect too. This is at 20. Hypholoma, the sulfur tuft, doesn't do particularly well against Phlebia radiata. Look what happens with a few degrees higher temperature. Completely the opposite. Hypholoma has completely grown over Trometes and through it. It completely replaces it. So we're likely to get different communities developing in wood with global environmental change, global climate change. Invertebrates too affect fungi. And this is a grazed system that you can see here. This is Fanerochaetae and Hypholoma again. I will later on show you the controls, the ungrazed systems. In this case, it's grazed by a Calembolan Falsomia candida. But just notice, there is some of the grazed regions there. Now this is a bit interesting. This is something, again, totally new story, new talk this will be on invertebrate effects on fungi. Different grazes have different effects on fungi. Different fungi are affected differently. Hypholoma is not usually grazed very extensively by Calembola because, in fact, it kills them. So you can understand they wouldn't want to eat it. But there's clear evidence of grazing just there. And if we blow that picture up a bit, you can see. So is it now that mycelium is more palatable because maybe the Fanerochaetae has degraded some of the compounds it normally produces, or maybe it's just that all of those hyphae are leaky and made a much better meal? I don't know. Now, quick bit of time lapse, and it is very quick. That's the same interaction that you're just seeing up there. Let's watch it again. And maybe one more time for luck, because I rather like this. So Fanerochaetae has replaced the Hypholoma. Now, actually, we can analyze mycelial architecture. And again, this would be another talk too. We can look at how mycelia are constructed. Mycelia are constructed in very different ways. And we can digitize mycelia. Some poor soul clicks with their mouse on each branching point, joins up each of those points, and measures the intensity of the image to get some idea of thickness. Now, actually, over the last couple of months, some wonderful IT person, computer person, has made software that can actually pull out these images instantly. So I think the sky's the limit for us now. But at the time, it was really rather hard work. So the false color you can see here, the dark red indicates thick cords, and the dark blue indicates very fine cords, and the other color are in between. So we can watch how these mycelia develop during this interaction. See it again, and if you look, you can see very dark red, that means great big thick cords are being produced. But there's other things we can do too. This time we're not looking at the thickness of the cords, we're looking at something rather different. And this time I've actually showed you the control, which is the ungrazed system. So no calendula in that system. In this one there were calendula. What we're looking at, obviously the images are now, this instant in time, but the false colour represents the change in the last 33 days. So the dark red means there's been new growth in the 33 days before the photograph was taken. The blue means that hyphae have disappeared completely. And the green colour means that there's been no change. And you can see considerable differences between these systems. So in the grazed system, Fanrakiti hasn't managed to grow in these regions. And that's because it's been nibbled extensively. On the other hand, look at this. This is really remarkable. Look at all this mycelium growing over hyphaloma. Doesn't do that in the ungrazed system, at least not yet. Maybe it's protected here from those calendula grazing because they don't really want to be on the hyphaloma, which is toxic to them. I think there are all sorts of very complex things, very interesting things going on there. You will have noticed probably that I'm really posing rather more questions than I'm able to answer. Keep me going for the next 10 years or so. A few more examples though of how invertebrate grazing can affect the outcome of interactions. This top row are ungrazed systems, so they're the controls. These are the grazed ones. In this instance, the grazing was by calendula and falsomia that you've seen already. Hyphaloma against Resinicium. Resinicium gets to the woodblock and replaces it. With calendula grazing, all of the mycelium is completely grazed away. So each of the fungi remain in their respective woodblocks and they will carry on decomposing those. Hyphaloma again, different strain. It looks different, it's because it's a different strain. And I emphasize that we do try wherever possible to use lots of different strains. There's a terrible tendency in biology, I think, to work on one strain of variety or whatever of a species, and then from that say, this is what the whole species does. It really does not work. These fungi, different strains will behave differently. Anyway, hyphaloma against Resinicium, again, Resinicium does well. This time we have got nematodes in the system, and you can see a total difference. Hyphaloma replaces the Resinicium. And in this last example, we've got wood lice. I can't remember what you call them here. Isopods. Resinicium against Fanrakiti. Fanrakiti is doing okay. It's struggling a bit. But look at this system here. It gets there, but the mycelium is really in a rather bad state because wood lice heavily graze fungi. Calendula are dainty eaters. They will eat the very fine mycelium. Nematodes, or these particular nematodes, insert their stylets and feed. Wood lice are really rather like lawnmowers. They graze huge, vast areas. And then millipedes are rather like windshield wipers. If this is their head, they graze like this and have totally different effects as well. Nearly everything I've said has been about species of fungi interacting just in pairs, although I've brought in the idea that other organisms are important with the soil invertebrates. Again, this is a bit yellow, I'm afraid, but I put these pictures back in to remind you that in nature, fungi are interacting on all sides, not just two of them interacting, very often three, four, five, six all together. If you look at one of these columns, there are several fungi around it. Look at this one, there are lots of different individuals. Think in three dimensions, there are very many more. So we've been looking at very simple situations. How will our work extend to the more natural situation? Can we predict what would occur? Well, if species A beats species B, and species B beats species C, and species A beats C, you know what the outcome will be. A takes over all the territory. But you probably guessed that in real life, things are not that simple. We get the situation where A beats B, B beats C, but C beats A. So you can't possibly predict from that what will happen. Perhaps this is a slightly unexpected, but fungi operate different combative abilities, produce different chemicals when they fight against different species. So that's probably why that occurs. We have had a little look at how fungi interact with more than one fungus. So Fanariceti, three wood blocks, each occupied by a different species of fungus. When they're paired in pairs, Fanariceti beats them all. But when there are three, it always, even though they all meet at the same time, it always goes for the weaker one. That's why I put fungi are bullies. They go for the weakest first. In this case, it's Kretschmeria deuster, the ascomycete. It replaces that one, then moves on to the next. I emphasize they met at the same time because the mycelium was originally here and we put those three wood blocks on mycelium at the same time. And excitement above excitement here. 1st of October today, new students starting in Cardiff to look in three dimensions at what happens in terms of replacement, gene expression, etc., etc. Had this rather good idea. You'll remember maybe Rubik's cubes, those infuriating things where you twist them to get all the blocks in the right direction. Imagine yellow is one fungus, green is another, red is another. This would be a mimic of decay columns in wood. And you can do all sorts of combinations, random, but making sure you've got the same numbers and they're not touching, etc., etc. This experiment will be starting any minute now. Actually, it probably won't, will it? Because I don't know what time it is in the UK. They've probably all gone home. Okay, we've spent too much time in the lab. Let's get out into the field where these things are really happening. Does combative ability relate to timing within a decay community? Well, of course, this has been known for years. Yes, it does. We find that the first organisms that usually are in wood decay communities are really rather poor combatants, and the ones later on are better. They have to be, because there's something already there and they have to replace it. Very late community is rather different because those fungi are often able to cope with stressful conditions, low nutrients, etc., etc. Okay, next question. Does each species affect the outcome? No, I can't read. Does each species affect the community that subsequently develops? In other words, is what is there, does it affect what is to come? It's a rather supernatural sort of question, I think. And we're just analysing the data for this experiment now. It's a rather large experiment in which we colonised wood discs with individual fungi, put them out into the woods on the forest floor 2 years ago, and looked at different times, 6 months, 18 months, 2 years, put them out in different seasons, etc., etc. These are actually uncolonized controls, which was why they've got all sorts of strange fungi on them. And just to look quickly at the results, these are the early colonizers, the things which come in, which we know come in early. These are sort of middle stage, and these are a little bit later. And we've got 4 sampling times. This is after 6 months, 12 months, 18 months, 24 months. Surprise, surprise, well, no surprises at all. After 6 months, these early colonizers are there in quite a few of the wood blocks, but not really after that. The later ones, they manage rather longer, maybe 18 months, although Sterium hirsutum, look, that's still there after 2 years. interestingly, it's, in this case, at any rate, with this strain, it's not a particularly brilliant attacker, but it's a great defender. So abilities in attack and defense are not necessarily the same. And then here we have the cord formers, which are really rather good and have stayed there for a long time. Hot off the press info, non-metric multidimensional scaling, showing the differences in the communities of things which came in to those individual fungi. So these are the early colonizers, which are quite clearly distinct from the later ones. And there is Sterium hirsutum, which again has a very distinct community structure. So time is marching on, so I think I need to be drawing swiftly to conclusions here. So maybe we'll summarize a few things. Fungal battles actually alter the way that fungi search for new food resources. I haven't really shown you that today. They also influence where nutrients are kept in mycelium on a large scale. I'm not thinking on a cellular level. They also influence release of nutrients, and I'll illustrate that in a minute. They affect decay rate and respiration rate, CO2 evolution. And also, because these battles affect which communities develop in wood, they influence decay rate in that way, because different fungi decay wood at different times. So if you've got different communities, then inevitably you will have a different decay rate. But let's look at these two things. These are my best unpublished experiments. I think we'll need to do these again, and it's a shame we didn't publish at the time. So, trays again, soil, fungus competing with another fungus. This was in my phosphorus period in the 1990s, my P32 period. Add P32 there in one series, add P32 there in another, follow where it goes. And where it goes is, it'll go to the battlefront to start with. It'll be present elsewhere as well, translocated within these cord systems. But when Phanerochaetes starts replacing Hypholoma, you'll see that the phosphorus moves dramatically to the other side. So there's huge relocation of nutrients in mycelia during combat. And then this other thing, this is really important, release of nutrients. Saprotrophic fungi are inherently greedy. They live in an environment which is relatively poor in nitrogen and phosphorus. So when they've got nitrogen and phosphorus, they don't want to lose it. So they keep it. But we know they must release it, because otherwise plants would not continue to grow, because ecosystems would run out. So we know they release it. When do they release it? Well, the guess is that they will release it when they're grazed upon by soil. Organisms, by soil animals, but also, I thought, when they fight. So we set up some of these trays, and we had perspex barriers in the soil, and then we labelled in different places. We also had holes in the bottoms of each of these trays, so that if you watered them, the water would come through, and so would phosphorus. So my hypothesis was that the phosphorus would be released in the interaction region. And like so many of my ideas, I wasn't quite right. Yes, phosphorus was released from there. So I was right in a way, but phosphorus also was released from other regions too. So it seems that the whole of these mycelial systems became leaky during combat. And that I had not expected. And then to illustrate the fact that CO2 evolution changes during interactions. Got time along here, CO2 evolution up here, six different combinations of fungi fighting. The red ones are the ones that win, but the point to note is that there's a massive increase in respiration as soon as they start to fight. They're paired up there. In this case, we measured CO2 evolution after a week. And then you can see eventually, after 84 days, it comes down. Perhaps we should look in more detail just at this one. This is Resinicium against Hypholoma again. That's Resinicium against self, Hypholoma against self, then when they're paired. Massive ramping up of metabolic activity. And then later on, when the interaction has finished, a decrease. in 10 seconds, I put this in because I'm in a lab where they're all interested in mycorrhizas, and I felt it really would be remiss not to point out that wood decay fungi interact with mycorrhizal species. That's a wood decayer, that's the mycorrhizal fungus there. Plant's been chopped off in this instance. There is Paxillus involutus, there is Fanariceti vellutina. Fanariceti is doing very well, thank you. It's going to replace that mycelium completely. However, it's not doing as well perhaps as you might think, because if you look at these mycelial tips, they're in a pretty sorry state. So it's not getting it all its own way. But just let's look at the effect on, in this case, allocation of sugars. There's the mycelium of Paxillus involutus when it's growing alone. So we had little plants here. We fed them with carbon-14 dioxide, and then with an instant imager recorded where the sugars that were made in photosynthesis had gone. Dark red means loads of carbon-14 sugars, labeled sugars. Blue is quite a lot. Then if you look here where the Fanariceti is fighting, you can see that there's very little allocation of photosynthate to that mycorrhizal mycelium. Even more impressive with Suilus bovinus. Masses of Suilus bovinus fighting Fanariceti again. Starts there, and there it comes out. I always think this is like a beating heart, but let's stop it so we can see masses of photosynthate, in this case around the region where the roots are, really. So rather different distribution. Let's look at what happens when the fungus, the saprotroph, fights. Very little allocated elsewhere. Some of it actually gets to the wood block, you can see. And on that note, I think it's probably time to stop and say thank you very much indeed for inviting me and for your patience.
About the fungi competing with each other, roots from plants must have to face each other all the time too. Are there commonalities between the two kinds of combat? Plants against plants and fungi against fungi, or plants against fungi too, I think.
Well, this would be like the answer to most of the questions you'll ask me. I don't really know. I mean, we know that many root systems produce all sorts of allelopathic chemicals, and I suppose in the sense that fungi are doing the same in producing inhibitory chemicals. But I don't know whether they're the same or not. Except, I think we probably do know the answer to some of that. So with the volatiles, one of the most common volatiles produced by fungi during combat are sesquiterpenes. Now, they happen to be produced by plants, for example, in response to invertebrate damage, insect damage. So I'm sure that there are probably lots of commonalities. Other volatiles that are produced are things like aldehydes and ketones and quinolium-like products. Of course, we all know, don't we, that fungi produce volatiles because you can smell them. You know the smell of mushrooms and toadstools and the smell of rot. That mushroomy smell is often 1-octen-3-ol, the same chemical that humans actually respire that and sweat that, and it attracts mosquitoes. I've gone off the track here. It attracts mosquitoes. I get bitten terribly by mosquitoes, so I think that I must be producing lots of this. I think I'm probably turning into a mushroom.
That's one more thing since you're a fungi. I just came back from Mount St. Helens, which I hadn't seen since it blew up. There are tree stands there from 1980, which are still standing, that the fungi have been impotent in getting rid of all that wood.
Do you really think they have been impotent? You really think they're not in there decaying? They will be in there decaying. So the main things, if you've got a house and you've got rot in your house, wet rot or dry rot or whatever, it will go quickly, but you can stop it straight away by getting rid of the water source. So often when you see these standing dead trees for a long time, like in northern boreal forest, you get these kilo trees. It's because they've usually dried out very, very much. They will go eventually.
I'm surprised you don't see conidia forming in some of these weaker guys just to sort of repopulate that.
Yeah, so yes, so they do have escape responses. So often people say when fungi fruit, oh, they're doing well, aren't they? They're producing fruit bodies. But often that is a response to stress, to adversity. But they've got to produce some really rather, they don't produce, these fungi don't produce many asexual spores. I mean, some of them do. Obviously, ascomycetes and things do, but these particular basidiomycetes don't. You'll sometimes see Hypholoma producing little, dainty, tiny fruit bodies in culture, but you also see escape responses in the terms of the mycelium. So I showed you systems that were only this big. That's not really satisfactory to be looking at that scale, because in the real world they operate over very large scales, these things that grow across soil. And you often see them when they are paired and they've got room to go, that instead of carrying on this battle here, they will go that way. They take flight, they run effectively. So they do escape. It's the one behind you first.
So, what's known about the interspecies signaling? Is there some kind of self-non-self recognition system?
There most certainly is self-non-self, and probably you could address that another day to somebody like Louise, who is an expert on that in ASCOs, but certainly basidiomycetes do. Yes. And they recognise not just, well, for individuals of the same species, recognition is usually mostly following contact when they fuse, and recognition is within the cytoplasm. But they certainly recognise each other from a distance, because you will see changes in the hyphae. And also these fungi will sometimes start producing chemicals at a distance. You saw the mycelia, which never met. They're recognising non-self in different species at a distance there. So there's a huge amount of non-self recognition going on, both at a distance and following contact. I don't know if...
We are out of time, but I'm sure she'll be happy to answer the question at the reception, which is right after this. Thank you very much.
Thank you.